Good morning, New Psalmist Baptist Church. I'm Dr. Al Bailey.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm Dr. Yolanda Bethay, and it's just a privilege to be able to worship with you on this great morning.
This is Old School Church Sunday here at New Psalmist Baptist Church. As you can see, we are dressed a little differently. We're dressed in our ministerial robes. This is the way we used to dress at our old school Sundays at New Psalmist back in the 1990s, 1980s, early 2000s. We would wear our robes first Sunday of every month. And so for Old School Church Sunday, it's going to be a dynamic looking back at New Psalmist history, looking back at church history. We want you to gather your whole family around because we're going to have a great time looking back at our history, at what God has done with us and through us at New Psalmist Baptist Church. You're seeing even now on your screens what the old school church feel was like. And trust me, New Psalmist, we're going to be taking you back all service long, just looking back at some of those old traditions that we would have at New Psalmist.
Prepare yourself for a great day of worship. We have old school praise and worship this morning. We're going to have a dynamic word from the Lord, from our bishop on this morning. It is an exciting day to be in worship together.
Don't forget, make sure you register for our Black History University virtual experience. It actually starts tomorrow. We're going to have Dr. Eddie Robinson leading us off. He's going to be talking about the music of the Black church. Dr. Eddie, Yolanda has two doctorate degrees. And so you don't want to miss.
God bless him.
You don't want to miss Dr. Eddie. He's going to be with us Monday. On Tuesday, we're going to have Preserving Our History. Professor Dale Glenwood Green, New Psalmist's own, is going to be talking about preserving our history. Do you know that Dale has a connection in his history and his family history to Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman? So you want to make sure you tune in for that. Yolanda, tell us about those other two.
We're going to have Dr. Jewel Dedman here about African American traditions on Wednesday. We will also have the importance of voting and voting history by Professor Gilda. She will be in the house, and we don't want to miss this exciting opportunity to learn what we didn't learn in school through our Black History University.
Also, New Psalmist, don't you forget, we are also registering persons for our STEM CX internship right here, 2024 internship. It is going to be a dynamic opportunity. This Sunday is the last Sunday to register. So if you have a child who's interested in cybersecurity, coding, environmental science, architecture, healthcare, make sure you get them to go to our STEM CX website, stemcx.org website, and sign up today. The deadline is the 29th of February. So make sure you sign up. Parents, again, this is a competitive process. So you want to make sure you sign up for that. So many other things that are going on. We're getting ready for voter registration right here at New Psalmist. So make sure you are signed up to vote. This is probably the most important election we will ever have at New Psalmist Baptist Church. So New Psalmist, we're excited about all the things that are happening. Trust me, it's going to be a great time in the Lord here at New Psalmist Baptist Church. Yolanda, you excited about this series?
I'm excited about this series. Let's see who we have worshiping together in the chat today. Good morning. This is Facebook Live. Keith Brockington. Good morning, Facebook. Rochelle Turner, good morning to you, and Ava Smith. Why don't you drop in the chat where you're worshiping from on this morning? I see Priscilla Lawson. She is worshiping with us all the way from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Good morning to you.
And you know, I can't forget my YouTube folks, my YouTube family. I see you, George. Great to see you this morning. Type in the chat in the YouTube's on the YouTube screen just what we're just who you're representing, where you're at in the city, where you're at in the state. I see Cheryl Brown. Cheryl, it's great to see you. Sonia, I see you. Of course, good morning, Miss Terry Portillo. Great to see you. Dorleen, it's great to see you. Say good morning to somebody in the YouTube audience today. Trust me, we're going to be fellowshipping and worshiping together. Even if we are online, we're still going to be in Old School Church Sunday today. If you still got time to go ahead and put on that church hat, get that church outfit on. Yolanda, you got to put on some stockings because, you know, Old School Church, you didn't go to church with no stockings on. So you got to make sure you get yourself
and your
ready.
Slip.
And yes.
And your slip.
But we are excited about this series here at New Psalmist. Trust me, it is going to be a great, great, great service today. Old School Church, the pulpit's going to look a little different. We're going to be getting ready right here for this great worship service here at New Psalmist. So again, gather the family around. We're excited about what you're going to learn. And you get ready for the post show right here at New Psalmist. We'll be back with you. We're going to talk about what's going on at New Psalmist. And until next time, until the post show, we'll see you. Again, I'm Dr. Al Bailey.
I'm Dr. Yolanda Bethe.
We'll see you at the service. Let's go to worship.
My brothers and sisters, it comes the hour for us to begin worship. Oh, will you come to your feet? Can you put your hands together and give God some serious praise this morning? It's good to be in the Lord's house. It's good to be able to come and share and worship together. What a mighty God we serve. I wish I could just thank God for life and strength. Come on, give him glory for it. Give him praise for it. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. This is the day the Lord hath made. Back in old days, when I came to New Psalmist, we opened the service with what we call the call to worship. And the call to worship, oh come, let us magnify the Lord together. Let us worship and bow down before the God of our salvation. For he is our God. He is our God. Great is the Lord. And greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Lord Jesus, meet us this morning. We come invoking your presence in this worship because you are God all by yourself. And we've come, and people are coming, marching to Zion, streaming up to Zion. We open with our choir processing. Back, we're marching to Zion. Play it, Brother Austin. Bring in the choir. I need some folk who remember when the choir marched in. Eddie, we're going way back now. Oh, march choir. Let it ring, Brother Austin. Oh my God, I'm down on Franklin and Cathedral Street. Yes.
when the organ was in the balcony. When we started down there, the organ was in the balcony and would ring out over the church. The piano was at the front, and the choir would come marching in their robes, and some choirs in their mortarboards, ready to sing praises to the Lord. To Zion. All right, church, let's open our mouths and sing to the glory of God. We're marching. Come we that love the Lord. Sing it, church.
Join in a song with sweet accord, and thus surround the throne, and thus surround the throne.
We're marching.
Lord, this morning, I want you to reach across those aisles, hold hands with somebody. Sweet hour of prayer. Kind of excited today. I was talking to Brother Willie Hicks this morning, and we were sharing about what's been happening in the world, and he shared with me that his son, Samantha's son, specialist Isaiah Hicks, had come back home from a deployment to a very hazardous area. All of us here have been praying for him. God's got Isaiah back in church this morning. Praise God. Praise God, Isaiah. I thought it not robbery then to have his grandfather lead us in prayer this morning. Deacon Sam, you lead us in prayer this morning.
Most holy and everlasting. It's again we come in the name of your son Jesus. And as we come, we thank you, Lord, because we know we serve a God who's worthy to be praised. Lord, you have been blessing us down through the years, my Lord, and my God, I know full well it's time that men, women, boys, and girls will consider who you are in their lives and do that which is pleasing to you. I thank you, Lord, because I know you brought us all the way, Lord. And I must admit, sometimes I feel like a motherless child. But I'm so glad to know that I've been around long enough to know. If I just wait just a little while longer, shut up, good God Almighty, you'll make things all right. I thank you, Lord, because I know full well that somebody prayed for me. I never got too wild, Lord. You know about me. I never got too wild. But great God Almighty, if I wasn't right, I was wrong. So I say thank you, Lord.
Thank you
for blessing all of your people, Lord. I thank you, Lord, because I know, my God, I know full well that if we will just let you lead us, Lord. Let the mind be in us that's in Christ Jesus. I thank you, Lord, because when we look back on our lives, on my life, Lord, I realize I could have been gone a long while ago. 9/11, I found, you know, Lord, I found out I had cancer, but you took care of it, Lord. A few days later, Lord, I found out, great God Almighty, I had a stroke. You took care of that, Lord. Satan thought he had me, Lord, but a few days later got another stroke, Lord. Good God Almighty. Satan's working on me, Lord. A couple of years ago, Lord, good God Almighty, I had a heart attack. You took care of that, Lord. Is there anything too hard for you, Lord? No, it's not, Lord. You can move mountains. Thank you, Lord. You can bring folk to a New Solomon's Baptist Church and let them realize, by God, with you we can make it. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I thank you, Lord, because we've had sickness, Lord, but you've cured some of us, Lord, but not all. It's your will, Lord. Do what you want to do, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, yes, I'm pretty happy today, Lord. For I know the prayers of me, my daughter, son-in-law, relatives, and then they got to admit, my brothers and sisters in the New Psalmist Baptist Church prayed for my grandson, Lord. over 10 times where he was, Lord, that they bombed the place, Lord, but you protected him, Lord. Good God Almighty, thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
And Lord, I know I got to get there and sit down, but I will just say this, Lord. I'm praying, Lord, for this world, Lord. I'm praying for spiritual leaders, Lord. Spiritual witnesses in high places, Lord. Thank you for taking care of that, Lord. Lord, there's so much. So I just say, Lord, thank you for all your many blessings. And Lord, when we've gone the last mile of the way, receive us in your kingdom, Lord. This and all other blessings we ask in thy son Jesus' name. Amen and thank God.
Sweet our prayer. Some of y'all remember this. I need us to lift this melody. Us, as you may admit, worshipers. Sweet hour of prayer. praisers in this house this morning. Look at somebody and say, we have an old school church, but I got a new day praise. I got a new day praise. Anybody come with a reason to praise God, then tell the person beside you, excuse me, but I got to shout this one out. I got to praise. Come on, choir, bless us now. I gotta let it out. I gotta praise, and I gotta let it out. You don't know like I know. I gotta praise, and I gotta let it out. I gotta praise. Touch somebody beside you and say, you don't know what I've been through, but I gotta praise, and I gotta let it out. Whoa! I need you to lean over to somebody and tell them, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I wouldn't have made it this far, but he's made a way for me. Look at somebody and say, you just don't know. I think I got about 20 people in here who've had a you just don't know week. I think there are about 20 folk in here that a you just don't know week. Well, I think you ought to praise the God who brought you through. Yes. Oh, yes, Lord. I just can't stop praising his name. Whoa. Cause he's been so good. My God. If there's anybody here who knows he's a prayer answering God. Anybody here know he's a way-making God? Uh-oh. Anybody know he's a mind regulator? He's bread when I'm hungry, water when I'm thirsty. He's a doctor in a sick room, a lawyer in a courtroom. He's all that and a bag of chips. And when I call him, he answers. You can take your seat if you can. But if you feel like jumping up and just hollering, thank you, go right ahead too. If you're seated beside somebody you don't know, just say, excuse me, but I act like this all the time. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and what he's done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah, thank God for saving me. It's like an itch you can't scratch. Go ahead, Ed. Go on and get your shout in. Woo! Shout it out. my God. My God. You know, one of the official acts of the church in the old days, I'm going to ask Sister Denise to come and welcome our visitors this morning. Give Deaconess Denise McCray a hand as she comes to welcome all the visitors.
Good morning, New Psalmist. I say good morning, New Psalmist. It gives me great pleasure to welcome our online visitors as well as first-time visitors here. All visitors, please stand.
All of our visitors, wherever you are, would you stand?
And online, please raise your hand.
Get in that chat if you're visiting online.
So I was told to say, because this is old school Sunday, I welcome you once, I welcome you twice, I welcome you three times in the name of Jesus Christ. We are so happy and excited that you chose to visit with us today. We ask that you come back. We have plenty of room for you to bring a friend. And New Psalmist, let's welcome our visitors. God bless you.
I'm so glad to have worshiping with us today friends of our church, friends of our church. You know, yesterday, and you'll see video of that in a few minutes. Yesterday, we had a tremendous community involvement day, and it was just out of this world. And working with us in this project, and she's been a friend of our church for years now, Sarah Heminger with Thread. She's the CEO of Thread. They helped us get into the food pantry business, helping folk. Sarah, won't you stand? Amen. So glad to have her worshiping with us today. Thank you for all of your help. And another longtime friend of our church. I've known her for more years than either one of us care to write down. But sharing with us this morning is a mayoral candidate, our former mayor, Sheila Dixon. I want her to stand. So glad to have her. We used to work out down at the Baltimore Athletic Club. That was not yesterday. But so glad she chose to come and worship with us today. Now listen, I'm telling you, I'm loving old school Sunday because I can see all of this. I said to my children, I asked them what would it be inappropriate if I had come today with hair. You know, all these new barbers now can put hair on your head and they look, some of y'all got it, you know, so don't be hating. And I was gonna come with the hair I had. Al shaking his head too. I said to him, do you think that it would mess with my sermon? Walter Jr. said, ain't nobody gonna hear you. Joshua said, have you lost your mind? And Joy walked out the room. So I had to come with hair of this year, even though we're having church of last year. So Sister Stacy, would you come and share the announcements today? Oh!
Good morning, church.
Good morning, Sister Stacy.
And these are your church announcements. Is our old school Sunday. Please join us after service for an old-fashioned collation. That's cake and punch for those who don't know. In the Narthex, and in keeping with the old school church theme, the cafe is offering church dinners. So after service, go on over and pick yours up. The menu today includes crab cakes, fried chicken, sweet potato souffle, two types of mac and cheese, and collard greens.
Don't go till service is over.
Church night out at the CIAA basketball tournament is this coming Tuesday, February 27th from 2024, starting at 6:30 p.m. Go to the member services desk to get information on how you can get discounted tickets using the promo code CHURCH10. The STEM CX 2024 internship. If you are a high school student, 16 or older, and are interested in coding, cybersecurity, engineering, I'll repeat engineering, that's a shameless plug, healthcare, environmental justice, architecture, or space exploration, go to stemcx.org, that's STEMCX.org, and apply for the 2024 STEMCX Summer Paid, I repeat, paid internship. Parents, calling all parents, this is a competitive application process, so please prepare your students. Applications are being accepted now through February 29th. So go to stemcx.org today. Our social action ministry will begin voter registration on the first Sunday in March. During this election, we want to ensure that everyone eligible to vote is registered to vote. The gym is reopening. Does that excite anybody but me? Oh, okay. As we are relaunching our fitness ministry activities, we are starting the Zion Fitness Center. The fitness center will be reopening on March 1st, 2024. You can go to the church center this week to sign up. And our virtual Black History University, which you didn't learn in school, starts tomorrow, February 26th, and will run through February 29th. We already have 367 people signed up. Go to Church Center to register today so you can get your login information. The classes that we'll be doing are History of the Black Church with Dr. Eddie Robinson, Preserving Our History, Professor Dale Glenwood Green, African American Traditions, Dr. Jewel Debman, and The History of Voting Rights, Professor Gilda Daniels. We want you to mark your calendars for the following important dates. On April 7th, we celebrate the 49th pastoral anniversary of our very own Bishop Thomas. There will be a pre-installation service for Pastor Thomas on April 14th at 4 p.m. Communion. The First Baptist Church of Glen Arden will be our guest. And our installation for Pastor Thomas is going to be May 4th at 10 a.m. So we're excited about that. And last, the New Psalmist Baptist Church is celebrating 125 years. Our church anniversary celebration will be on June 30th, so be sure to be here. Now, that concludes our church announcements. Turn your attention to the screens for a video presentation about our church's history. Thank you.
In the sacred rhythm of time, our journey through Black history is intertwined with the heartbeat of the church, a sanctuary that has stood as a bedrock of strength, a refuge in times of struggle, and a beacon of hope that has illuminated our path. From the depths of slavery, where whispered prayers were the only solace, to the echoes of hymns that reverberate through the civil rights movement, the church has been both witness and catalyst in the narrative of our resilience. In the hallowed halls of our spiritual homes, we found sanctuary when the world outside sought to deny our humanity. The struggle was profound, but within the church, a flame of hope burned bright, a flame that ignited not only our spirits, but also a fervent belief in a future where justice and equality would prevail. The pulpit became a podium for change, and the pews a gathering place for the faithful warriors of justice, Through prayers, songs, and collective strength, the church became a cornerstone in the fight for freedom, a testament to the transformative power of faith. Today, as we stand on the shoulders of those who knelt in prayer and marched in protest, we recognize the enduring role of the church. It is a wellspring of hope, a space where the struggle is acknowledged, and where we find the strength to overcome. Let us celebrate the role of the church in shaping our collective history. It is not just a building, but a living testament to the resilience of a people who refuse to be defined by their trials. Through the hymns of yesterday and the prayers of today, the church continues to be a guiding force, steering us towards a future where justice, equality, and love reign supreme. As we gather in the warmth of this sacred space, let us remember that the church is not only a witness to our history, but a catalyst for the hope that propels us forward. May the church forever stand as a symbol of our shared journey, a journey marked by struggle, resilience, spiritual growth, and the unwavering hope that guides us through every chapter of our remarkable history. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'd like all the ladies who are wearing their hats and fascinators to stand wherever you are. Come on. Oh. Now, Chip, after service, we're going to take a picture of the, Sister Stacy, can you come to the mic and let the ladies know when the meeting is for?
The meeting of the Ladies That Wear Hats Society will meet down front after church for a photo. Thank you.
Yes. We must get a photo. Thank you, ladies. We must get a photo of this moment. Yesterday, my brothers and sisters, was absolutely awesome here at the church. We had our Black History Community Resource Giveaway. This coming week, we have our Black History University, things you didn't know. And that's going to start this week, and we want everybody online sharing with it. But yesterday, we had the men's breakfast, we had the women in their cafe conversations, and upstairs, this whole floor was occupied for our outreach with the community. And the community was here. The community was here. Reverend Al, can you step up here a moment just real quickly? I want people to get a sense of, even as the screens are sharing footage, I want them to get a sense of what yesterday was all about. Tell the congregation what we did.
Good morning, church. Yesterday, we actually had members of our community to come in and receive resources from all over the city, all over the state. We actually partnered with Baltimore City. We also partnered with the Enid Pratt Library, partnered with Thread, and we actually were able to give out 179 free, somebody say free, free laptop computers yesterday. Somebody ought to give God praise for that. Bishop, we also partnered with nine churches around the city to make sure we blessed 2,000, we gave away 2,000 coats, children's coats. It's cold. And we were able to bless children all throughout this city. We knew we couldn't give away all those coats by ourselves, so we partnered with other churches around the city. And we partnered with nine different churches to give out all 2,000 coats, and they're all gone.
Amen.
We also blessed persons with free food. We had our partners from Baltimore City Community College, the Community College of Baltimore County. They gave out information about jobs as well as free tuition opportunities. And they're going to be coming back even more to share more resources that they have. But so many opportunities. We gave out information about voter registration. We gave away tons of food yesterday. Bishop, it was just absolutely amazing.
Would all of those who shared in the effort, would you stand wherever you are, all of those who helped make it happen, would you stand? I need you to put your hands together for them. These men and women were out early, stayed late, And they were a tremendous blessing to the families that came. God used us to bless others. We are brothers and sisters, ministering to brothers and sisters. And our mission is... Amen. Al, did we do that yesterday?
Bishop, we did it in an amazing way. God showed up and he really blessed so many people. We experienced God yesterday and the community experienced God yesterday.
Amen. Come on, put your hands together. It's amazing how God moves in such a special way and did what he did. Families were here. Persons had tears in their eyes being helped. With gas and electric, we had our social services ministry out helping folk figure out how to navigate systems. Our prayer teams were out for folk who needed prayer. It was something to see. Black History Month is not just a time to wear dashiki. It's a time to help our community and to make sure they understand that we are brothers and sisters making life better for somebody else. So I hope this week you will jump online with us. We've got 300 and some folk, almost 400 folk already registered for the university. Amen. Already registered for the university. You can go and sign up right after service. We got classes on the history of the Black Church, preserving our history as a people, African American traditions, and the history of voting rights. You heard Reverend Al mention voting, Sister Stacy mentioned that we'll start registering voters next Sunday. The aim of New Psalmist is that we'll have what percent voters? 100%. Persons will say, well, I don't see anybody worth voting for. I don't feel my vote counts. Whenever you take that attitude, your chances are you're voting for the very person you don't want to see win. If you want somebody to win, you have to vote. If you want your voice heard, you have to state it. We're living in critical times, my brothers and sisters. They get more critical every day, every month. And if we want to see change and if we want to have and maintain anything, we need to vote. Next Sunday, we'll be starting our voter registration. We're also doing voter registration certification here. Brother Pete, Minister Pete, would you just stand? We're doing voter registration certification. In order to register people to vote, you have to be certified. And so we want to certify people who want to help. Somebody said, well, I'd like to be involved, but I can't do this, I can't do that. There are so many small jobs you can do, one of which is being certified for voter registration. Pete and his team are going to make sure you get trained in that so you can be certified. We want to be involved. And I invite every person, whoever your candidate is, join their effort to win. Because the only way they're going to win is somebody works for them to win. Amen. Look at somebody and say, this is not the year to complain. This is the year to commit. Y'all didn't hear what I said. This is the year to commit. This is the year. I don't seek to be a prognosticator of doom. But what I do know is, if we want to see this experiment called democracy continue, because it is not a given, if we want to see it continue, if there are rights we feel we do not have yet, and we want to experience, then we need to commit ourselves this year to the voting cycle that is before us. And we cannot sit back and talk about, I ain't sure. Get sure. You got a couple months to get sure. Because the Lord Jesus Christ has called us to be committed. And we've got to cast our votes this year. I know in my own spirit, I have never been, I voted in my first election in 1968. And that was when we had the Vietnam War. And I thought that was a perilous time. But I think we're living in one far more perilous now, at least in my lifetime. And I tell you, do not take this experiment called democracy lightly. French philosopher said, in a democracy, you deserve the government you have. Why? Because you voted for it. So let us make sure we make votes count and make sure we're registered. Anybody living in your house, you tell them they want to keep living there? Register and vote, because voting got you that house. Somebody better hear me. I want to see the hands of folk who really are just grateful for the things that the Lord has done for you. Just for a moment, you alone deserve the glory, Lord. You alone deserve the honor. You alone deserve all of my praise. I remember driving to church in my little Mustang and then in my Cutlass Salon, then in my Buick, straight on up to being old enough for somebody to drive me to church. But every time, coming with excitement about what God was going to do in these different locations we were in. Can I see the hands of folk who remember North Avenue and Druid Hill? Franklin and Cathedral Street. Remember the aisle that went all the way to the side on both sides, but you couldn't get out on that end. Remember, everybody thought we had the most magnificent walls in the world, and we found out they were paint. You alone, Lord, deserve the glory. Remember, can I see the hands of those at 4501 and a half? What God did for us there. Put us on television, allowed us to ministry at levels we never imagined, do outreach in ways we couldn't think. Then he brought us here. I want this morning people who really know it was God in your life. Stand where you are. Oh, choir, it's old school Sunday. I want us to touch a little bit of that. Oh, just about everybody standing. We all standing because he alone deserves my praise. You alone, Lord. I just want us to lift the line of that. And if you feel like waving your hand when we do it, wave your hand. Deserve the glory. You alone deserve the honor. You alone deserve all of my praise. So I lift my hand. Lord, I worship and adore you. No one else deserves the praise. You alone deserve my praise.
No one else deserves the praise but
you.
Is there a witness?
You alone will I call worthy. You alone
will I call mighty God.
So
I lift my hands to love.
Lord, I worship and adore you.
No one else deserves my praise.
You've been through a lot.
You alone deserve my praise.
You
alone deserve my praise.
God. You are God. You are God and God alone. You are God. You are
every now and then, you just have to remember, He's God. And He's got this. Can I see a wave of hands from folk who remember when your situation started and you were nervous and wary, but God has shown you every day He's got you. And He's got it. Come on, come on. He's shown you. Oh man, what is good? And what does the Lord require of you? You do justly, you love mercy, and you walk humbly with Him. He's got you. 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 Say it quiet. You are God. One last time.
You are God.
You are God.
You are God.
My God. You may go to your seats. We're getting ready to give out gifts now. Our prayers are with First Lady Jarette Thomas in the passing of her great grandmother. That funeral is going to be in Memphis, Tennessee this weekend. We're praying her strength as she makes that journey. I want everybody to remember something on Old School Sunday. He's still God. And He's God alone. Can you look at somebody, shake your head and say, "Whoa, you just don't know." We're getting ready to give. We thank God for every gift, every offering you give. It helps us to do the work that you heard Reverend Bailey mentioning, the other projects and programs we do. We just are so grateful for all that you do. Many of you give on a recurring basis through your electronic giving. That helps us to get so many things in order because we can project. So many of you give electronically. That helps us tremendously. Oh, what a great God we serve. Play it, Tavon. He's fit to rule, fit to take the universe's throne. We give because God's been good to us and we see the advance of His kingdom. There's so many things that we're trying to accomplish. Your gifts make it possible. On Easter Sunday, we want to give the biggest offering we've ever given. I'm asking everyone on Easter Sunday, the fifth Sunday in March, to tithe on that Sunday. Somebody said, "What's a tithe?" That's the first 10%. The Bible says that God told us, bring the first 10%.
See what I do with 10% and know what I'll open the door to happen in your life with the other 90. Whatever God is doing in his church, it's a sign of what he can do in your life and what he wants to do in your life. How many of you have seen God put his hand on your family and on your life? We give not out of duty, not out of obligation, but we give joyously to the Lord. You can't beat him giving. We give joyously to the Lord because we never give him anything that he wastes. Moreover, I have learned that I don't miss what I give to the kingdom. I've learned that God has a way of pouring back. Is there anyone in church who's ever had the Lord give you back more than what you've ever given out? Then let's prepare to give now. Father, we give these gifts for the upbuilding of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, use them. We pray, amen. Now, as we stand, I want to remind all of our young adults, Wednesday night, we gather in the Connection Center, all of our young adults, 6:30. Don't forget, this Wednesday night is our time together. The ushers, may we all stand. And if you're giving electronically, just hold your phone up or your instrument up. We thank God for all of those gifts that are being given. Good to see all of you in church today. Be sure to come downstairs after service for the collation. Amen. Look at somebody and say, what's that? Church punch. Amen. It's in the narthex. Oh, excuse me. In the narthex. That's right. In the old church, we ain't had no basement. In the narthex. All around the complex. Y'all better, I should let y'all say this. It's everywhere. You can raise your A1C. Just get some cake. Amen. All the diabetical people, wave your hand. We don't have diabetical cake today, but we do have church punch. Amen. And then our ushers are going to march in. Well, it's old school Sunday. I remember we'd have ushers' anniversary. I'd march the ushers in, go take a nap, and then come back for the rest of the service. Amen. The ushers are going to be coming in with their gifts. Ooh. Amen. Move. That's right. Here come our ushers. They moving on down. Praise God. So glad to see Sister Pam Connor back with us today. Good to see you, Pam. Amen. Pam moved across the country. We told her we're going to drag her back over on this side of the country. Praise God. The ushers are getting ready. Oh, they're a little slow over on this side today. Amen. Thank you all for giving so much. Amen. Amen. Them baskets must be. Thank you. Praise the name of the Lord. All righty. Some of y'all in the new church haven't seen the old church. We're going to try at this. I'm trying not to laugh. Okay, the ushers are going to get ready to come on in here. Y'all ain't seen nothing like this in a while. Oh, they standing up, they getting ready. May we all come to our feet as the usher boards and the hospitality of the New Sominex Baptist Church.
Around. want to offer you.
true praise. My God. My God. Oh, Nelson, we're going way back. I want to offer you true. Would you, on this last Sunday in February, would you open your Bibles to the first book of Corinthians? I knew we were going to have church today. First book of Corinthians, the 15th chapter, and beginning with the 50th verse. Choir, let me thank you for blessing us. You pulled out them robes today, and you sung with power. Would you open 15th chapter, verse 50? I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. Oh, for the trumpet will sound. The dead will raise imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself in the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of sin is of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. But thanks be to God. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord. Because you know. Hey, you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Oh my God, you may go to your seat. Trying to take a text. something. There's something about that last phrase on this last Sunday in African American History Month. I want you to touch the person beside you and tell them, hear these words. Stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Touch somebody and tell them, this is the triumphant conclusion of it all. Don't stop working. There's no doubt, my brothers and sisters, that progress has been made for our people since our arrival on these shores in the 1600s. The physical abuse that was uniquely ours, sanctioned by a constitution, we no longer are forced to endure. Our brothers and sisters can, some of them at least, can navigate the rocky terrain we call our culture and life. We've come a long way from the bottom of that ship, landing on Plymouth Rock, or as one person said, as Plymouth Rock landed on us. We've come a long way. We learned to read in a society that didn't want us to read. We made progress in a world where everything we do is talked about in the negative, so that the narrative about us can be continued. There's no doubt we've come a long way, over a way that with tears has been watered. The slaves saw the plantation and the misery it brought and the life that was forced upon it as something they could not escape. Every system of their society worked to keep them as slaves, and they had to run away to be free. Finally, after more than 100 years, the back of slavery was broken, and our people marched out of into freedom. They were able to move north, move east, move west, but yet they always knew the only way they were set free was by the hand of a mighty good God. They didn't mind singing, "Over my head, there's trouble in the air. There must be a God somewhere." They prayed in brush harbors, prayed in the field, sang spirituals that not only lifted their spirits, but lifted their heads, and reminded them of the words of the psalm. The words of the psalmist that says, "I will lift up mine eyes to the hills." And then he begs the question, "From whence does my help come?" But you know it's good when you can answer your own question. And he hollers out, "My help." God, I wish I had about 5 people in here. Somebody's wondering how you got where you are, how you do what you do. My help. Somebody's looking at you saying, "I don't see how it's done." My help comes from the Lord. And in case folk didn't know who he was, he said, "The maker of heaven, help me somebody, and earth." The slaves knew without a shadow of a doubt that this God, the God who liberated Israel from the oppressive force of Pharaoh, was the same God that set Africans free in America from the oppressive system they lived under. And they had
they made no bones about it. The Lord is my rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. God, I wish I had a witness in here. But you know, my brothers and sisters, as the years have passed, many now even question the existence of God. Amen. I'm not talking about folk on some planet like Mars or Jupiter. I'm talking about folk on good old planet Earth. I'm talking about folk who look like us, who even wonder, is there any reality to this thing called the existence of God? They buy the Marxist propaganda that religion is the opiate of the people, that the only reason we come in here and do this is because we are unwilling to take responsibility for our own lives. I got news for them. Some of the stuff that's happening in my life wasn't my responsibility. Can I find five people in here who know some stuff was dumped on you? Can you wave at me if I'm on your street? They don't believe that there's a God who sits high and looks low. The slave, however, saw heaven as the place of the great refusal, where God would refuse some folk entrance who made life miserable for others. They would sing a song, "I got shoes." Talking about heaven, I got shoes. You got shoes. All God's children got shoes. When I get to heaven, I'm gonna shout all over God's heaven. But then they'd add this little line and they'd look at the big house and they say, everybody talking about heaven ain't going there. God, I'm over somebody's head right now. Everybody talking about heaven ain't going there. Then they would say, you better mind, my brother, how you walk on the cross. Your foot might slip and your soul be lost. They knew that it was God who made a way for them. And if the things did not change over here, God had a home on the other side. I remember being a young boy hearing them saying, we're the wicked. Shall cease. God, I need some old choir members. From troubling, the weary shall be at rest. All of the saints of the ages, God, can I get a witness? Will sit at his feet and be blessed. They didn't have two nickels to rub together to make a dime. They were barely able to keep a roof over their head, but they knew in the sweet by and by, I got a home in glory and I'll see him on the other side. They had respect for what would happen over there, the kingdom comforts that would be theirs. But in 2024, when doors are opening for us, when we can live anywhere, drive anything, and have anything that credit will buy you. God, I wish I had a layaway church. Do I have anybody who remembers layaway? Layway. We left the A out. Layway. Money gone. You had to pay on your layway. And if you didn't pay on your layway, they put your layway right back. Help me, God. But in 2024, when we bourgeois, bumpy, ghetto fabulous, we seldom embrace that concept, except at the passing mental memory of a loved one at a funeral, when we want to hear that heathens went to heaven. I got quiet on that. Somehow folk who have no time for God want to make sure loved ones gonna be in a place they want. Oh, it's getting even quieter. Because somehow we don't want to talk about heaven until dying. But them old slaves knew, no, heaven is a reward. for having survived this thing called life. I need five people on my street who know you have fought a good fight. My God, to be honest, the fact that there may be something beyond life seems to be of little or no consequence to a whole lot of people. But I've come this morning on old school Sunday. I've come on old school Sunday as an older man to say I believe there's a place on the other side where that God has prepared for us. Can I find five witnesses in here with me? Jesus put it this way, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Because in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told, I'm quoting Jesus. If it were not so, I would have told you. If there was no heaven, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you that where I am, there you may be also. And I've come to preach to my brothers and sisters to tell you that no matter what we are facing on this side of Chile, Jordan, there is a victory that belongs to us. And there is a triumphant conclusion to this thing called life. Do not sit in this pew this morning and think that life is nothing more than the ticking of the clock on your existence. You were born on a certain day. You will die on a certain day. But do not think that is the end. There is something beyond the mortal veil of time. God has sent his son Jesus to get ready for what happens when we leave this side. Let me preach this thing. I got to talk it so you understand it. You've got to get this. Before Jesus, the world wrestled with life because all it had was the time between birth and death. And I tell you, my brothers and sisters, living just between birth and death will wear you out. Can I see the hands of folk who know you've dealt with hell you wish you didn't have to? Can I see the hands of folk who had folks heap stuff upon you? Can I see the hands of folk who've had folk lie on you, dig a ditch for you, set a trap for you, try to destroy you? Come on, don't say, if you haven't had it, don't die. Keep on living. You've got a date with death and a date with pain as you go along this journey. And the question that life asks, is this all there is to it? I need to see the folk who honestly admit every now and then you've wondered, is this all there is? Do all I have to do is struggle, suffer, go through hell? The people of Corinth had heard Paul preach. Corinth was a metropolitan city. At one time it had been important, but then it had fallen off the radar. But the Romans had made it great again. Most of its people were immigrants. And it had become a great city. And Paul had been there and he had preached the word. And people had heard about this man, Jesus. Now, what Jesus offered was a way to handle life. A way to live without falling apart in hell. Let me see if I can cook. David put it this way, if I make my bed in hell, you're there. But Jesus said, no, I came to show you how to put gasoline on your shoes and walk through hell and get to the other side. Now, I don't know who I'm talking to, but I know there are about five people in here who've walked through hell with gasoline on your shoes and you have made it to the other side. What was meant for evil to destroy you did not succeed. You were in a ditch and you got out. Your heart was broken and it healed. You cried and your tears were dried. Somebody better feel where I'm coming from. Jesus Christ, and if you wonder what he offers you, first of all, a way to live your life in the hell you find yourself. To be able to look at trouble and say, you gotta move because I'm still coming. To be able to look at heartache and say, I'm down today, but I'm getting up tomorrow. To be able to look at disappointment and say, this is not going to stop me. I may be down, I may be bruised, I may be battered, but I am getting up from here and I am going to make it. You knock me down, but don't walk away. Stay right where you are, because you're going to live to see me get back up. I need about 20 people in here who know that folk thought you were done, you were finished, you are over, but look at somebody, nudge them, say, the devil is a liar. Uh-oh, I'm trying to preach this sermon, but nudge somebody, say, I got Jesus with me. I got Jesus will pick you up when you fall. Jesus will dry your tears. Jesus will put strength in you. And guess what? If you don't have anything left to fight with, he does. He will step in front and fight your battle for you. Paul says to the church at Corinth, because the church at Corinth is struggling. All of these false gods are in their land. They are suffering persecution, and they die earlier than we do. The average age, life expectancy of a man back in Paul's day was about 35. You can hear a rat run across the floor. Look at the person beside you. Don't say nothing. Maybe a fight. Chances are, centuries ago, they wouldn't still be here. You know, when I don't know if I told you this, when I was growing up, Social Security was about 65, somewhere in that age, 65 you had to be to get your Social Security. But most black men didn't get it. Because when I was growing up, the average age of a black man was 67. Most of y'all on your 10th year Social Security checks. They want some of us to die. Thank God they're gone. They were in the high income category. But when we were growing up, most of our folk didn't live to collect, because they died early. In Paul's day, these folk are dying early. So life has to have some more meaning, because y'all don't have but so much time. And so they're questioning, I know Jesus, but is this all there is? Struggle all the time? And so Paul writes this letter to the church at Corinth, 1 Corinthians. It's really his second letter to them. The first letter he wrote to them is really in chapter 7. He drops some lines in there in chapter 7 about sexual things. That's his first letter. This is his second letter. And he deals with all of the issues they have, because folk got issues. Even church folk got issues. Y'all got issues. I got issues. All the issue folk, wave at me. Look at somebody and say, I know you're right. All of us got a bunch of issues. We got issues all the time. So Paul writes to them, and he begins to answer their issues. They got a question about who should they follow. Paul, the Cephas, Apollos, who they should follow. They have questions about whether they should eat food that's been offered to idols. They've got question about communion, how they should do communion. They've got question about whether women should even talk. They've got question about whether you take saints to court and sue them. All these kind of questions. They've got question about, do you cut folk off that really live in messy? And Paul says the last of their questions, or the biggest one for last, the last of their questions is, what's going to happen when I close my eyes? And see, I think sometimes there's some questions you ought to get settled before it happens. Paul says, let me tell you, I can't explain it in a way that you'll fully understand, except to tell you it's a mystery. Jesus Christ came to do two things. One, to show you how to walk through hell. Because I don't care how good your life is, you're going to walk through hell. I don't care how sanctified you claim to be. You're going to walk. You can keep all of the scriptures, and hell's still going to find you. You can quote the entire Bible. You're good, too. Gonna find you. Jesus says, I've come to show you how to live through hell. How do you do it? You keep your eyes up. You talk to the Father every day. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, in prayer and supplication, make your request. Ask and it shall be given. Seek and you'll find. Knock and the door shall be opened. Cast your cares upon the Lord because he cares for you. Whatsoever you ask in my name, believing, I will pray the Father and he'll give it to you. Stand bold. Don't you worry about anybody coming up against you. Hitherto, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask that your joy might be complete. Jesus said, I'm going to give you everything you need to be able to handle everything you've got to face. Don't you stand up there and back down to some bully and fall apart because some situation is messing with you. Your money is funny and you think you can't make it. Don't you know your Father owns a cattle on a thousand hills? He can let you go in a sock drawer and find money you hid from yourself. Somebody better hear me. He'll help you make every bill, every obligation. And guess what? They take one house, I'll give you an apartment. I'll still keep a roof over your head. Every time it looks like a door shuts, I'll open another door. And I'll make you like a mouse. If you can't get through a door, I'll let you wiggle through a hole. Help me, somebody. But you will never succumb. You'll never succumb. I will show you how to live in hell with a smile on your face. I'll let you eat in an air-conditioned place in hell while everybody else is burning up. When your enemies and your foes come up against you to eat up your flesh, they will stumble and they will fall. No weapon formed against you will prosper. It may rise against you, but it will not accomplish what it thinks it is going to accomplish. This is the word of the Lord to the people of God. Jesus Christ has come that you can live through whatever hell you go through. I need you to look at somebody and tell them, I've come a long way, baby. Oh, God, if you understood what you said, you'd have shouted right now. Don't you realize you were supposed to be wiped out weeks ago? You were supposed to be finished a year ago? You were supposed to be done when the hammer came down on you? But look at you. Look at you. You don't even look like what you've been through. Because of the Lord Jesus Christ. Their second question is, is this the end? Is this all there is to existence? Is this all there is to it? It is if you don't understand what this is. See, the people who think this is all there is to it see God as playing a game with us. And once he's finished with us, we're done. That's not the plan. God is putting us through all we're going through to get out of us everything that doesn't make us look like him. What do you mean, preacher? In Genesis, we're told that we are made in the what? Oh, y'all make me feel good in front of all these visitors. Sheila, you hear us. You hear us. You heard us, sir. We know the Bible. Eddie, you heard him, didn't you? In the image of God. But sin has messed up the image. You know, God gave us creation, Genesis 1, Genesis 2. By Genesis 3, we'd messed it up. It didn't take us long. How many of you know you can mess up a good thing? Come on, wave it. Some of y'all lying. Take the hand of the person beside you and raise it up. Say, don't fool yourself. You know you can mess up a good thing. The plan of God was for us to be fruitful and multiply and to subdue the earth and to do what God wanted, but we messed it up. And we ate of a fruit. That's all symbolic. We ate of a fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. In other words, we put into our system stuff we couldn't handle. And the effect it had on us was to take us places and cause us to do stuff we couldn't get away from. Because some stuff you stop doing, but you can't get it out your head. And so God sent Jesus not to have us have it. an experiment of just living from point A to point B, then you're dead and you're done. No, God created us to be forever with him. But in order for us to be forever with him, he had to get some stuff out of us so that when he calls us back to himself, we look more like him than we do like us. Y'all still haven't got it. And so all of our struggles and trials here are but for one purpose. To get us prepared to be more like him. Because every bit of hell you've been through has made you wiser. I would be of little value to you if I hadn't had hell in my life. How am I going to help you understand the posture you need? I can tell you facts. I can give you knowledge, but knowledge comes from books. You don't need knowledge, you need wisdom. And you share wisdom from your experience. God, I need somebody to celebrate the wisdom that life has brought you, and the wisdom has helped transform you into the person you are now. But you ain't finished yet. Oh, God, I wish I had somebody who could say, even at 60, I got stuff I'm learning. Even at 70, I'm being transformed. Even at 80, I'm being transformed. Though the outward man perisheth, the inward man is renewed day by day. Day by day, I'm getting closer. I'm more like him. I'm thinking more like him. So that when I close my eyes on this side, I will open them up on the other side. And I will know him even as I am known. Paul says, you all are misreading this. If you think it ends when you close your eyes. You misreading your life. You think your life's journey is about you getting, you doing stuff and having stuff. George Washington was rich. They keep his home as a memorial to him. What else he got that's around here? I don't know. Phyllis used to sing, you can build skyscrapers great and tall, but only what you do for Christ will last. Baltimore City didn't look like downtown Baltimore didn't look like that 200 years ago. All them folk who got rich off and walked around with their chests out. You know, I read the journal and read all of the things that are opening and what's happening, and I marvel at it, and I salute the people that do it. But don't think it's gonna last forever. Baby, they will tear that down when the tax credits are over. And guess what? I remember when there was nothing at the Inner Harbor. But an Inner Harbor. They will tear all that down and build new stuff. All that goes. You're going to spend your life on something that's gone and people won't even remember you. If I'm going to be forgotten here, at least let me be remembered there. Paul says, this is a mystery. I got to tell you this because you're wondering about dying. He says, mortal is going to put on immortal and perishable is going to put on imperishable. Now, I'm not going to go into all of that, what all that means, because that's one sense of it. But I don't think that's his real drive. His real drive is intended to say to them, listen, look at your life and you will know this can't be the end. You'll realize it can't end when you close your eyes. I got a mama on the other side. I will see her. God, I've got some friends. I'm on somebody's street right now. I'm going to see them. Yeah, I'm not going to close my eyes and be in a box for all eternity. No. When you fade away, your bones and all, everything finally decays and nothing is in the box but dust. That's the end of you? That's it? People talking about, I want to save my brain. You better let that brain go, baby. Get it transformed, not saved. Don't put it in a jar. Don't get it, put it in a jar. Get that thing transformed by the renewing of your mind. And if you want to renew your mind, all you need is one thought in there. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noonday, Jesus when the sun goes down. How many of you know the thought of Jesus has transformed your life? Y'all ain't feeling where I'm coming from. The thought of Jesus has built new neural pathways in your mind. You think different because of Jesus. You act different because of Jesus. You see things different because of Jesus. And even though you may not be everything you ought to be, you are working on who you are and you are shouting about who you are becoming. Paul says, it's a mystery. And you can't understand any of this if you don't accept mystery. That there are some things that you will never figure out. But the reason you won't figure it out is because God himself is a mystery. His ways are not your ways. His thoughts are not your thoughts. How many of you know if you were God, you wouldn't bless you? Frida, somebody about ready to fall out in here. Look at somebody and say, I know I wouldn't bless me. No, we wouldn't bless out, but God is a mystery. God blesses us even though there's so much mess in us. God blesses us even though we go in the wrong direction. God blesses us even though we make our bed in hell. Why? Because God loves us and his love transforms us. And when his love brings us through hell, it gives us new things in our mind to consider. And after a while, we start saying, I know there is a God. I know he walks with me. I wish I had somebody in church today who could affirm, you know for yourself that God is real in your life, that Jesus is your Savior. Paul says, I've got to tell you this. He says, there's a triumphant conclusion to everything. And this, when you realize what the end is, you can shout about the beginning. He says, you can shout about what you're going through. He said, you know why I say this to you? Because I know in my gut there's got to be better than this. I know many of us in this room know that God's been too faithful to us for us to believe that there's not more to the goodness of God than what we've already experienced. God's been blessing us from day one. I mean, he has made your enemies your footstool. He has opened doors that just blow your mind. You know that there's more to this. And this is what Jesus says. Jesus says, when you know the end, you can endure. When you know how stuff is going to turn out, you can handle what you're going through. I'm preaching to folk right now who's sitting in here going, I don't know how I'm going to do this, how I'm going to handle that, how I'm going to handle it up. I need you to go back down memories lane. This is not your first rodeo with trouble. This is not the first time your back has been up against the wall. Am I talking to anybody? This is not the first time the devil said, you're mine. This is not the first time you've been hurt. This is not the first time you've been lied to. But when it happened before, God said, watch me work. And when you know that God's going to step in every situation you face, that no weapon is going to be able to succeed, you can hold on as long as it takes. You can keep on fighting. Why? Because I ain't going down. You can keep on fighting. Why? Because God's going to put a smile on my face. You can keep on fighting. Why? Because the Lord is going to make a way out of no way. I wish I had some folk in here who remember when the door was solidly shut and all you did was stand still and God blasted a door open and made a way for you to come out. Somebody ought to shout on that right now. You ought to praise God for the fact that there's something beyond here. There's something after this. Jesus said, you got to get this. Jesus said, first reason I left glory is so you can understand how to live in hell and realize you can conquer whatever the hell is. I'm looking around at this congregation of people who I've known for 49 years almost, who I have seen come through hell and high water. Your backs have been up against the wall. Your children looked at you sometimes and thought you'd fail and you wouldn't be able to make it. But you kept coming back up. You kept getting back up. You kept surviving. Now you're talking about, I don't know how I'm going to make it. The same way you got here is the same way you're going to make it. On your knees, trusting and believing, calling on the name of the Lord, driving your car with tears coming down your face, shaking their hands under your chin, saying, Lord, I need you. I need you to make a way. And God saying, just hold on a little while longer. I got you, child. I'm going to take care of you. And then God made the clouds blow out of your life. I need about five people in here who are legitimately can say the Lord fought that battle for me. The Lord delivered me out of the hand of the fowler. Jesus Christ came to get us through hell, Chris. But he also came to let you know that everything you're going through is for a purpose for where you're going. So therefore, let somebody say, learn your lesson. Learn your lesson. Don't just learn how to be rich, learn how to be righteous. Learn your lesson. Because when you learn your lesson, you start realizing everything I have, I owe to him. Everything I'm doing, I owe to him. If it hadn't been for him, I would never survive what I went through. But yet, in the twinkling of an eye, God made a way for me. God kept my enemies from gloating over me. I can't speak for anybody else, but I want to shout sometime when I walk past my enemies. I just want to do this. Then I want to put on the George and stroll by because I know he's a good God. I know he's a way maker. And Jesus says, see, the thing is not the victory itself. It is what the victory has shown you about your relationship to God. The victory has shown you he'll never leave you. He loves you with an everlasting love. That's why he says, now stand firm. Oh, stand firm. Don't fall apart when trouble comes. Stay in the fight because your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Look at somebody and say, that's what makes me shout. And the part I'm going to close on this because my time is gone, but I got to tell you this. The part that really gets me when Paul is talking to the church at Corinth, when he gets to this part, is he says, you know, life is hard. Life is hell. He said, I've been through all kinds of things. He was jailed. He was beaten. He was shipwrecked, beaten a bit by snakes. He was carted off from one place to the other. But in it all, he never lost his joy. Why? Because he knew the Lord will. The Lord will make a way somehow. If there are 15 somehow saints in here, make yourself known right now. Somehow I made it. Somehow I made it. Through it, oh God brought me all. I was laying on the bed sick, but somehow my money was funny, but somehow trouble was all around me, but somehow my mind was playing tricks on me, but somehow I made it. So that now Paul says, don't fall apart when it's getting rough. Know that that's what the journey is. Know that that's how you have to make it. But no, it's not going to end with that. So what I need you to do, Paul says, don't get weary in well doing. Well, if I can't get weary, what do I do? If I can't cry and fall apart, what do I do? Paul says, instead of being weary, start worshiping. Start praising God. I want to show you what I'm talking about. No matter what was going on in your life, you came to church on old school Sunday. You came in here when I got on my Kente robe. The choir has on their church robes. And I saw Carolyn come down the aisle in her nurse's outfit, her usher outfit, and her white nurse shoes on her feet. That's old school church. All of us got some new day problems on us. But when the choir started singing, and when they started saying true praise, or when they sang sweet hour of praise, or call him up, when they started singing them songs, something inside of you said, I can't stop praising him. Even though it gets rough sometime, I got to praise him. Give somebody an anyhow pat. I got to praise him anyhow. And I promise you this, when you praise God, trouble has a way of lifting off you. When you praise God, burdens began to wipe away. Do I have a witness? When you praise God, joy breaks out in your spirit. That's why I saw somebody run around the church, because they couldn't keep it to themselves. Well, I got news for you. When life has done the worst it can, when your body begins to break down, when the funeral director says it's time to give me a call, I heard Jesus say, don't worry about it, worship anyhow, because I've got a home for you. I used to hear my pastor put it this way, there's gonna come a day when we won't be in church, when the choir won't be singing, Gabriel will put one foot on time and the other foot on eternity. There'll be a blast of the golden trumpet, and the dead in Christ shall rise, and those of us that are left shall be caught up. Do I have a witness? Be caught up to meet him in the air. I can't speak for anybody else, but I want to see him for myself. I want to see the man who died for me. I want to see the man who saved my soul. And when I see Jesus, I'll say amen. When I see Jesus, I'll say amen. My troubles pass. I'll fall on my knees. I'll shout hallelujah. Do I have a witness? Is there anybody here who believes there's a place? Is there anybody here who wants to see Jesus? Slap five with somebody. Tell them, I want to see him for myself. I want to see him for myself. I want to say thank you for saving my soul. Thank you for making me whole. Thank you for giving to me thy great salvation, so rich and so free. Do I have a witness here? Is there anybody here who can talk about heaven, the city of God, the city of God? There are 12 gates to the city, 3 gates to the north, 3 gates to the south, 3 gates to the east, 3 gates to the west. And when we go marching in, I heard John say, there's 144,000. But wait a minute, wait a minute. I see a number no man can number. Coming up, coming up, coming up. Out of great trials, I'll be in that number. You'll be in that number. When the saints go marching in, when the saints go marching in, I'll shout, battle fought, victory won. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Oh, I want to see him look upon his face. I will see Jesus. Hallelujah.
elevation and glory, honor, power to the Lord our God. For the Lord our God is mighty. Yes, the Lord our God is omnipotent. The Lord our God is all praises be to the King of Kings and the Lord our God. He is wonderful. This is not the end. When I stand before him, when I stand before him, he'll take all of this. Finish. Wait a minute. I need you to get this. The sixth word from the cross, Petey, is "it is finished." Comes from the Greek word teleos. Teleos, which means complete. Jesus said it so that we would know his work was done. Because when we stand before God, it will be finished. Look at somebody and tell them, he's still working on me. Y'all ain't get it. Look at somebody, tell them he's still working on me. But one day will, one day, it will be. Then I will understand, even as I am understood, this mystery called life was all about me getting ready to walk into his presence and not be ashamed. I don't care how good I am on whatever good day I'm in, I'm always a little ashamed coming before God. Do I have company? But there's coming a day when I will walk in his presence. All my mess be behind me. I won't be crying over it, because I'll be saying, God, you used all of that to get me where I am right now. Hallelujah. I want everybody to stand. I want to invite you into a journey that has eternal meaning. You can't handle the hell you have, but in Jesus Christ our Lord, he died for you, he died for me. When I said yes to him, that I would believe. I didn't even know what I was saying yes to. I knew I couldn't keep going the way I was going. Can I see the hands of folk who came to the Lord because you couldn't keep going the way you were going, Vanessa and Dale? Come on, raise them up high. You couldn't keep going the way you were going. You couldn't keep going that way. You didn't understand what all this believing is. But the Lord said, you make one step, and I'll make the next gang of steps. I'll show you how to be at peace. Oh, Karl Marx, you were so wrong. This is not a way of losing my sense of responsibility. This is a way of gaining my interconnectedness with my Heavenly Father. My children will always be my children. And I don't know who I'm talking to, but you will always be God's child. How many of you know you have your children's back? You think God doesn't have yours? If you're here this morning, I want to invite you to say, I'm going to try him. I don't know if it's going to work in my life, but I just want to try it. Come on down this aisle. Give me your hand. It was 1971. I sat in the front row of the New Shiloh Baptist Church, and I heard Dr. Carter say them words. One day, he's coming back. It won't be Sunday. Gabriel will put one hand, oh, praise God, somebody is walking. Gabriel will put one foot on land and one on eternity. I heard my pastor saying we shall be caught up to meet him in the air. I heard him say soon one morning we'll know. And I got up from that front row and I walked down the aisle. I gave my hand to Pastor Carter. I gave my life to Jesus Christ. I was baptized at that church, and God started showing me who he was. So that I'm not talking about something somebody else told me. I'm talking about it because I know him for myself. If you're here this morning and you don't have a church home, maybe Christ Jesus isn't your Savior. I want to invite you to walk on down this aisle. If you're scared to walk, I'll walk with you. But come, praise God, Antoinette, bring him on down. There may be one on the balcony in the load. You don't have a church home today. I got a feeling some folk need Christ. Would everyone bow your heads? Close your eyes a second. We're going home in a minute or so. Praise God. If you came to New Psalmist today and you're not a member of a church somewhere, or maybe you say, I used to go, but I don't go anymore, but you really feel like you're ready, you want something to change in your life, you need somebody praying for you, and I want to be that person. Would you just be so kind to raise your hand in the air while every head is bowed, every eye closed? Don't worry about who sees you. Only God can help you. Just raise your hand in the air. I want to be the one praying for you this week. You came to visit, but God had you here for a purpose. If you're seated beside somebody and you don't know them, just lean over to them and ask them, do you have a church home? Have you accepted Christ? If they say no, you share your testimony about how he made a way for you. Look at what God is doing this morning. People have walked down this aisle, and I got a feeling. Choir, sing it one time for me, because I think somebody else needs to walk on down and make the Lord your choice today. Say it one time, choir. Oh, we're going back. Praise God. Praise God, sister. Emily, we got one more. Praise God. Welcome to New Psalmist. Welcome. Glory.
there's nobody like Jesus. If there's another, come on.
Beautiful sight. Oh, play it, Elliot. What you hear is the call of the drum, that which is uniquely our heritage. We stand in the house of God, and every sense of this moment, we feel.
Sunday morning, we gather in church dedicated to your corner, but continue us praying to God.